rise up tonight with a greater readiness. Let us stand with a greater determination. Let us move on in these powerful days, these days of challenge, to make America what it ought to be. We have an opportunity to make America a better nation. I want to thank God once more for allowing me to be here with you. I left Atlanta this morning, and as we got started on the plane, there were six of us. The pilot said over the public address system, "We're sorry for the delay. But we have Dr. Martin Luther King on the plane. And to be sure that all of the bags were checked. And to be sure that nothing would be wrong on the plane, we had to check out everything carefully. And we've had the plane protected and guarded all night. Then I got into Memphis. And some began to say the threats, or talk about the threats that were out. Or what would happen to me from some of our sick white brothers. Well, I don't know what will happen now. We've got some difficult days ahead. But it really doesn't matter with me now, because I've been to the mountaintop. Like anybody, I would like to live a long life. Longevity has its place. But I'm not concerned about that now. I just want to do God's will. And He's allowed me to go up to the mountain. And I've looked over. And I've seen the promised land. I may not get there with you, but I want you to know tonight that we as a people will get to the promised land. So I'm happy tonight. I'm not worried about anything. I'm not fearing any man. Mine eyes have seen the glory of the coming of the Lord.
Martin Luther King Jr. was a charismatic leader of men with a remarkable gift for speaking. He was born on the 15th of January 1929 and became the driving force behind a mass campaign for change in America that culminated in the civil rights marches of the 50s and 60s. Tragically, he was assassinated in Memphis in 1968. That act of senseless violence denied him the chance of ever seeing his dreams growing into a reality. His widow, Coretta Scott King, remembers him as a man driven by love and a desire to see the unity of all people.
Martin Luther King Jr. was a man of love who loved unconditionally. He was a man who worked ceaselessly to eliminate the evils of poverty, racism, and war, all forms of violence. And he was a man who believed in truth and embraced it when he discovered it. He was a man of great compassion, but he was a man of action. He worked to bring about the realization of the goals he set for himself during his lifetime. And he believed in the possibilities of all people, that we could overcome whatever forces of injustice and oppression that that beset us. And he accomplished a great deal in his lifetime in terms of bringing about freedom and justice and many equal opportunities for not only black people, but poor people and white people as well.
The Reverend King was always aware of the constant danger to his life. America, in those days, wasn't receptive to his message of equal rights and justice for all. But, says Mrs. King, he carried on regardless in the firm belief that what he was doing was right.
He had a deep and abiding religious faith, and he believed that his cause was just and that there was a redeeming power in one's commitment to love and nonviolence, and that if one had to suffer and sacrifice, that was part of the price that was necessary to pay, because the rewards would transform themselves into bringing about necessary changes. And he even was willing to pay the ultimate price, and did, because he felt that that was a small price to pay for the cause that he believed in, and for to bring about a society of more justice and more peace.
60s America was a segregated world in which blacks were seen as second-class citizens with very little to say in the running of the country. However, Mrs. King believes that a lot has changed since then, especially in the area of the black representation in American politics.
We lived in a segregated society in the 60s, and we blacks and whites were treated as blacks were treated as second-class citizens and deprived of their right to vote, all of their basic rights, really. We were not until many campaigns did we achieve a civil rights bill that guaranteed public accommodations, the freedom of public accommodations, the freedom of access to public accommodations. And at the same time, in that process, women in this country, all women, were given more equal rights. Their rights became more equal under the Constitution than they had been. In 1965, we achieved a voting rights bill, which helped to bring about a larger number of elected officials, black elected officials, and policymakers in this nation. So today we have, in 1965, we had less than 500. Today we have over 7,000 black elected officials throughout the United States, and most of the mayors in our larger cities are now black, and we are very pleased with the progress that we've made, but still we are less than 1.5% of the total elected officials of this nation. So we still have a long way to go. We're making progress in that area. But in the area of economic justice, we have made very slow progress, very slow progress. That is the most difficult area of the struggle, and Martin Luther King Jr. did caution us that it would be most difficult, and that it cost the nation something. The other rights that we achieved did not cost the nation anything. But if you're going to achieve equality in the economic arena, it is going to be very costly, and the nation is not willing yet to pay that price. I do hope, though, that in the not-too-distant future, our nation will be able to reorder its priorities, because our nation has understood now that the large military buildup is not necessary, particularly since the emergence of Mr. Gorbachev and his policies of perestroika and the Cold War seems to be ending, and there is a new social order that's beginning to, I think, emerge there. We feel more, I think, the leadership of this nation feels more secure now, and less inclined to continue the build-up. As a matter of fact, it has been said by a Secretary of Defense that the defense budget has a potential of being cut by $180 billion. If that is the case, those monies should be directed toward some of the human needs in our nation, because we have not made progress according to the wealth of this nation and the resources that are here. And so we have too many people who are homeless, too many people who are still jobless, and people who are in poverty who have turned to drugs and to crime because they see no way out. And that's why Dr. King's nonviolence becomes so important. And the King Center, which is named for the Martin Luther King Center for Nonviolent Social Change, which is named for Dr. King, has been working on training leaders in his philosophy and strategy of nonviolence at every level of our society. And it is important as we celebrate his 61st birthday, the 5th annual holiday, and the 22nd year in the life of the King Center, which is named for Dr. King and whose mission is to perpetuate his legacy nationally and internationally, and to train leadership to address the problems of poverty, racism, and war in a nonviolent manner.
Martin Luther King Jr. conducted his campaign for change on a platform of nonviolence, which was criticized by other black leaders at the time as hindering the cause. But Mrs. King is confident that her husband's peaceful method of struggle was the right way.
There's no way that I could see that anyone could feel that it was a hindrance. There would have been no way for us to accomplish these goals in such a short time without nonviolence. Nonviolence was the key to the progress that we made in 12 and a half short years. I think it was miraculous, the change that took place here in America. And we had lived centuries under slavery and segregation, and there was no climate for change until the nonviolent movement led by Martin Luther King Jr. Emerged, and it was essentially that method of struggle that he injected that made the difference, because there have been other leaders who have led masses of people and called for change, but they did not have an organized, systematic way of teaching that method and organizing people to work for change.
The Reverend King was a great orator who captivated his audience and drew large crowds wherever he went. His most famous speech, I Have a Dream, outlined his vision of a new America.
It was a dream of a nation that responded to the needs of all of its people, that there would be a job, a decent job, an income for all people. There would be adequate housing for all people. There would be health care and educational opportunities for all people. There would be culture for the nurturing of the spirit, and where black and white people and Protestants and Catholics and Jews and Gentiles could live together in peace and harmony.
I say to you today, my friend, so even though we face the difficulties of today and tomorrow, I still have a dream. It is a dream deeply rooted in the American dream. I have a dream that one day this nation will rise up and live out the true meaning of its creed. We hold these truths to be self-evident, that all men are created equal. I have a dream that one day on the red hills of Georgia, the sons of former slaves and the sons of former slave owners will be able to sit down together at the table of brotherhood. I have a dream that one day even the state of Mississippi, a state sweltering with the heat of injustice, sweltering with the heat of oppression, will be transformed into an oasis of freedom and justice. I have a dream that my four little children will one day live in a nation where they will not be judged by the color of their skin, but by the content of their character. I have a dream today. I have a dream that one day, down in Alabama, with its vicious racists, with its governor having his lips dripping with the words of interposition and nullification, one day right there in Alabama, little black boys and black girls will be able to join hands with little white boys and white girls as sisters and brothers. I have a dream today. I have a dream that one day every valley shall be exalted, every hill and mountain shall be made low, the rough places will be made plain, and the crooked places will be made straight, and the glory of the Lord shall be revealed, and all flesh shall see it together. This is our hope. This is the faith that I go back to the South with. With this faith, we will be able to hew out of the mountain of despair a stone of hope. With this faith, we will be able to transform the jangling discords of our nation into a beautiful symphony of brotherhood. With this faith, we will be able to work together, to pray together, to struggle together, to go to jail together, to stand up for freedom together, knowing that we will be free one day. This will be the day when all of God's children be able to sing with new meaning, "My country, tears of thee. Sweet land of liberty, of thee I sing. Land where my fathers died, land of the pilgrims' pride. From every mountainside, let freedom ring. And if America is to be a great nation, this must become true. So let freedom ring. From the prodigious hilltops of New Hampshire, let freedom ring. From the mighty mountains of New York, let freedom ring. From the heightening Alleghenies of Pennsylvania, let freedom ring. From the snow-capped Rockies of Colorado, let freedom ring. From the curvaceous slopes of California, but not only that, let freedom ring. From Stone Mountain of Georgia, let freedom ring. From Lookout Mountain of Tennessee, let freedom ring. From every hill and molehill of Mississippi, from every mountainside, let freedom ring. And when this happens, when we let it ring from every village and every hamlet, from every state and every city, We will be able to speed up that day when all of God's children, black men and white men, Jews and Gentiles, Protestants and Catholics, will be able to join hands and sing in the words of the old Negro spiritual, free at last, free at last. Thank God Almighty, we are free at last.
Those people who had been left out and left behind in a way that would assist them in moving forward and closing the gap. And of course the nation still has not done that. Today we have more people in poverty than we did at the time of his death, and yet there have been many people who have moved up the socioeconomic ladder and who are part of the middle class. But those numbers are few compared to those who have been left behind. and who are struggling to survive, and they are barely surviving, Dr. King would be very disappointed, I'm sure, if he returned today and to see those conditions. But within the last 8 years, the last 9 years, we have a phenomenon in our country of homelessness and people who have to be fed day to day on a daily basis by the community and the government and the community within the city because they have no place to eat and they don't have money to buy food. And if they work a little bit, they don't have enough money to afford an apartment. And we didn't have this phenomenon of homelessness in our country prior to 1980.
Martin Luther King Jr. was a special man who inspired a generation of black Americans. But has anyone emerged to fill the void left by him? Mrs. King again.
I don't think that's the way it should be and the way it was to go. Dr. King lived in a period of time when there was a need for a person such as a Martin Luther King Jr. He was almost like, he was the Gandhi, which some people call him the American Gandhi, and that he was the Gandhi, the person who led the civil rights movement to free not only black people but many others from the shackles of oppression and the lack of equality that was so prevalent. Martin Luther King, I think, would be happy that so many people have emerged in government and in education and in the business professions and in many other areas, and they are leaders too. They are leaders in their areas, and we have so many today that are addressing problems in their area. So that you don't to have one person who is a fixer is not real freedom. What he taught people is that they could, through the power of nonviolence, if they could empower themselves and they themselves could work to improve the conditions of their lives, they could stand up for their freedom, they could lobby for their freedom, they could organize for their freedom, and that it need not be a one leader that would call all of the shots or give all of the the directions. We've seen this in many communities, the centralization of leadership, and that has been very good for the development of the people in those regions. So there is no successor to Martin Luther King. A person like Martin Luther King Jr. comes once, perhaps in a millennium.
Martin Luther King Day was instituted as a public holiday in America 5 years ago, following a long and concerted campaign by supporters, including Mrs. King herself.
I was right in the middle of it and really worked to make it happen. The work of the King Center and many of his followers, and certainly the efforts that I continued to put forth materialized when a massive coalition celebrating the I Have a Dream speech, the March on Washington in 1983, actually made it possible finally. We had worked over a number of years, and I was one of the few people who always believed that it could happen and that it would happen, and it would take time. And when the time was right, I proposed to the person who had been introducing the legislation that now is the time for the legislation to be brought before the floor of the Congress. And that was the process by which it eventually passed, the risk. And reluctantly signed into law by President Reagan. So it was not the Republican administration that caused it. It was the people who decided they wanted it, and they lobbied their congresspersons and made it happen. And, naturally, because I believed from the beginning that it was going to happen and it could happen, it was a great occurrence and didn't take anything away from it. But I did not have the same kind of excitement that someone would have who was on the periphery and never thought that it could happen. Because I'd had lots of experience in lobbying and getting legislation passed, and I knew the process, and I knew that it could happen and when the people decided they wanted to make it happen.
Happy birthday! beauty of all people. It's in the dream that you had so long ago, the glimpse of all of the hearts of people. Believe me. We'll make the dream become a reality. I know we will. Because our hearts tell us so.
Stevie Wonder's Happy Birthday. Mrs. King is confident that her husband's memory will continue to live on throughout history and that he'll be remembered for the great man that he was.
Everybody has their own memory of Martin Luther King Jr. And I think he is remembered, and it doesn't matter what I think, because he is already... made his mark, so to speak, in history. He is a person who lived by the example that he taught, and he achieved tremendous progress toward advancing humankind. And he's claimed by people all over the world of every race and every religion, and even the non-believers, as a person who lived a noble life and who transcended so much of what most people find themselves bogged down with, and who never achieved true greatness. He was truly a great human spirit, and some people have called him the greatest spiritual leader that America has produced. And I think I could agree with that.
On this very special day, Coretta King has a personal message for all of us celebrating Martin Luther King Day here in Manchester.
I hope that people around the world will, and particularly the listeners of this program, will be involved in celebrating Martin Luther King Jr.'s birthday as a time of nonviolence, a time to act and a way to live, living the dream by getting involved in some kind of action, reaching out and helping someone, feeding the poor. I know you have poor people in your countries. Martin Luther King memory should be honored by doing something and for someone else and serving your fellow human beings.